The Chernobyl accident. The physics clearly explained the worst nuclear accident in history. But why did it happen? Today I'll show you. Step by step I'll explain the relevant nuclear physics, I'll implement that in code and make a basic model of the Chernobyl reactor. Then I'll use the model to explain and redo the same terrible decisions in the Chernobyl control room, and you'll be able to see how the reactor responds and exactly what went wrong. A very simple reactor. But let's start with the basics. In any nuclear reactor, you must bring the reactivity up to power and keep it balanced there. The power from the nuclear reactor heats up water into steam, which then drives a turbine to generate power, which is done by fission. I do recommend watching my video about critical mass where simulated nuclear reactor and also an atomic bomb while going into deeper details about fission. But don't worry, I'll assume you are lazy and quickly recap now. I'll also start building up the model so we'll be able to simulate the Chernobyl reactor. The nuclear reactor uses uranium of the isotope 235. This element has the property of undergoing induced fission, which is when the element absorbs a neutron. The element will split, i.e. fission, into two new lighter daughter elements and release three new neutrons. Now, these daughter elements are not important for the bigger picture, so not to confuse ourselves visually in the model, instead of showing two daughter elements, I'll simply just show whether the element is uranium-235 or not. Blue for uranium-235, gray if it isn't. We can stack many uranium-235 in a metal grid and fire a single neutron. We just create a nuclear chain reaction. This is what we want in a nuclear reactor. Although we want it a bit more controlled and not this explosive. In the reactor, we will have different isotopes of uranium in the fuel, and only a few percentages is the fissile type, uranium-235. This is how the metal is extracted from the ground. Having highly enriched fuel in a reactor is not only extremely expensive, but also way too dangerous. You can see in this reaction, with a lot less fissile material, the reaction seems way more stable. The goal, of course, is to get the reactor up to some amount of reactions per second, and once you are there, you keep it stable by ensuring each loose neutron on average only hits a single uranium-235. Now, I want to add two more things to the model before continuing. These are just for helping my model and not really of any importance in actual reactors. The first thing I want to add is the ability to replace used up fuel. Since I only have around 1,000 simulated uranium nuclei, I need to be able to magically pop in new enriched uranium. The second thing I want to add in the model is the radioactive decay spontaneous neutron emission. This is when a radioactive element suddenly releases a neutron, a naturally occurring process. Let's give this property to all non-uranium nuclei, i.e. the gray circles. Building the simulation control rods. I want to simulate the same type of reactor used in the Chernobyl accident, the RBMK reactor, which apparently is not an abbreviation for a ridiculously badly made kettle. The first thing I want to add is control rods. Control rods have the property to absorb neutrons. And just to state the obvious, you can cool down a reactor blue by inserting control rods, and you can heat up a reactor red by removing the rods, allowing neutrons to flow freely. We don't have everything yet to fully simulate the RBMK reactor and its downfall, but for now, let's run what we have. It's a very basic nuclear reactor model. Normally, reactor reactivity is measured in megawatts, but I'll just count the number of neutrons present in the reactor. You can see that number on top here. I've coded some very basic automatic control of the control rods. Every second rod will go up if there is under 40 neutrons inside the reactor. If there is above 40, the control rods will be inserted instead. But as you can see, by slowly pulling out control rods, I'm able to increase reactivity safely, whereas reinserting the control rods decreases the reactivity. Building the simulation, water. Alright, let's keep adding real physics concepts to the model. As I briefly mentioned, the reactor is surrounded by water, which heats up and drives a turbine. I'll depict water as a small box. The water has a low chance of absorbing a neutron. Whenever a neutron scatters with water, it will transmit kinetic energy, heating up the water. In the model, let's add whenever a neutron is inside the water, it will heat it up. When water is cold, I'm coloring it blue and then fading it into red as it gets hotter. But I also want to add when the water gets too hot, it evaporates. When this happens, the water is gone and can no longer absorb neutrons. In my model, this is going from red to completely gone. When water cools off, it condensates and reappears. Let's try it again and fire even more neutrons than last time. The front of the burst is mostly absorbed while heating up the water. This means the backside can easily propagate without being absorbed. In reality, of course, there will be some temperature exchange between each water block, but let's just ignore that fact. You can also see the water reappears. So for our reactor, that means presence of a lot of water will keep the reactivity down, whereas heating up the water will lead to holes or voids, and the reactivity will go up even further. Reactors with this property are said to have a positive void coefficient. Let's see that in action from the example before with the control rods. Notice that we now have to lift the control rods even up further because the water is helping to absorb the neutrons. But because the control rods keep the reactivity down to 40 neutrons inside, you won't see enough neutrons to evaporate the water for now. You'll have to wait a bit to see the positive void coefficient in action. Building the simulation, xenon. For this chapter, I'll keep it short and concise and don't explain that much. After absorbing a neutron at a later time, the nuclei will have a chance to decay into the isotope xenon-135. I'll denote xenon with the same dark gray color as the control rods. Xenon has the property to strongly absorb neutrons. Once it's a xenon element, the only way to undo that is for the element to absorb a neutron. This is what is referred to as burning away xenon. Now let's run the model again with the xenon property. You'll see once again, it's now hard of the reactor and we must raise the control rods even further to get the same reactivity level, around 40 neutrons. Building the simulation, moderation. Last thing to add. When neutrons are released from the nuclei, they fly out with around 5% the speed of light. Let's add the property to the model. Now neutrons sent out from nuclei are fast. I will denote that with a white dot in the neutron. This speed is way too fast for fission absorption. It turns out the chance of interaction is incredibly low then. This is called the nuclear cross-section. It can be thought of as the probability of a reaction. When they are going fast, I'll set the interaction chance to 0%. For fission, you must first use the so-called moderator, something for the neutron to scatter on and absorb some kinetic energy. In the RBMK reactor, all fuel rods were surrounded by graphite for moderation. In the model, I'll depict a moderator as a white rod with a gray border. After collision with the moderator, the neutrons are no longer too fast and are instead called thermal neutrons, which basically just means slow neutrons. Let's have these thermal neutrons behave just as before with an interaction chance of 100% when the neutrons and nuclei touch. When thermal neutrons collide with the moderator, we will just set them to fly right through. To make sure we are on the same page, I'll run the model without control rods, water or the xenon property, only with the fission fuel and moderators slowly being inserted. Hopefully, this depicts the influence of moderation and the nuclear cross-section. This is yet another control of reactivity. Removing moderation means neutrons will have a much lower chance of undergoing fission, while more moderation means more neutrons will have a high probability of fission. Finally, let's see everything together. A lot is going on, so for this model I added a legend of all the different objects below. Now we have everything we need to recreate the Chernobyl accident. I'll recreate the same events as in the control room. Here's the first event. Day of the accident, event 1, reactor normal. The simulation I'm showing right now is showing how the reactor was running stable just before the accident. It was running at around 50% power to meet power demands for the grid line. The xenon was being burned off just as quickly as it was being made. Reactor is stable. We can pretend the 50% power corresponds to 40 active neutrons, which is what the control rods here are trying to stay stable at. To illustrate the states we just saw, here I'm plotting the reactivity of the reactor and according to the events. Event 1, reactor normal. For this event, the reactor was running at 50%. On this plot here, I'll show how many of the control rods was present, how much water was in the reactor. The water was stable, cooling the reactor down. Some voids here and there. I'll also plot how much xenon was present, not much. Day of the accident, event 2, power reduction. Let's continue the simulation from where we stopped last time. We'll do that from now on. Well, what happened then? A safety test was scheduled later this night. This test required the power to be reduced to around 30% power. We can pretend 30% power corresponds to 20 active neutrons and set the automatic control rods to try and hit this number. What we can see here is the xenon is still being generated from a delayed reaction when the reaction ran at 50% power, but only now 30% power burns the xenon away. Let's see the state of this simulation we just saw. The reactivity? Well, around 30%. Control rods were inserted in order to try and reach this reduced power level. For some reason they also increased the water flow cooling, meaning control rods has to be raised even further up. However, the lower power means not as many neutrons are present to burn the xenon away. Day of the accident, event 3, power drop. After that, the power unexpectedly dropped to 1%. Because of the high xenon buildup, we are reaching very low levels. I set the control rod to try and reach 20 active neutrons, but in my simulation we are reaching lower values because of the high xenon buildup. This is me trying to show you a reactor stalling and stuck in the xenon pit. This is the 1% unexpected power drop I'm trying to show that happened the day of the accident. So the power level is plummeted to 1%. They didn't change anything to the control rods, of course. The reactor was simply stalling because of the extra high water flow with no voids, and the xenon poison continually building up from the reactor running at 50% power. Day of the accident, event 4. Power up attempted. Now many safety systems were turned off, safety protocols ignored, automatic control of the control rods was turned off in an attempt to power up the reactor. They were only able to get the reactor up running at 7% power by pretty much removing all control rods. Notice the control rods are raised, but the water and xenon keeps the reaction in check. So, the state is 7% power, all control rods raised, water level is still cooling the core, and xenon keeps building up from the delayed reaction. Day of the accident, event 5. Test starts. The reactor was still stuck at 7% power. The computer warns them to shut down immediately, so they turn off the computer instead. They could not get the power higher than 7%, and yet they started the test. Pretty much all control rods are still raised. The test included switching off half the recirculation pumps temporarily. To reflect this change in the water pumps, I'll simply allow the water to cool off much slower. The effect is, of course, more water boils away, causing more xenon to burn off, and this is a positive feedback loop, causing ever more water to evaporate, causing ever more xenon to burn away. Right, so the reactor is stuck in 7% power. Pretty much all control rods are still raised, water is boiling away, quickly forming voids, causing more xenon to burn. The day of the accident, event 6, SCRAM. Now here's something I hadn't added to the simulation. The control rods actually had graphite displacers hanging below, looking something like this. Commonly said graphite tips. So actually, this whole time, the scenario should have looked like this instead. Now I'll add that to the simulation. Let's continue the simulation with these added changes. Let's pause the simulation. Suddenly, with the water and the xenon disappearing, the reactor increases unexpectedly fast in the reactor, and the operators notice this and presses the SCRAM button, aka AZ5, a safety switch. SCRAM button's job is to put in all of the control rods as absolutely fast as possible. It was a lifeline the operators always thought they had, in case something went wrong in the test. Anyway, pressing this SCRAM button, it will take some time to deploy the control rods. They are slow. The operator didn't know what they just had done, because normally the top had a lot more stopping power than the accelerating bottom graphite, but the reactor was in such an unstable state that the bottom had much, much stronger accelerating power than the top had a stopping power. As a result, the SCRAM actually increased the reaction rate. After a little, the control rods and graphite displacers were stuck. Control rods didn't get far enough in the reactor to do any difference. Let's just quickly see the states here and the pause of the simulation. The power had unexpectedly risen a lot. Control rods were set in by the SCRAM, but it was stuck. And all of a sudden, all the water flash boils away and all of the free neutrons burn away all of the xenon. Now there's nothing to stop the reactor. The reactor is just set in such a crazy state. It's just all gas and no brakes. Let's see that. Here you see the control rods with graphite displacers got stuck. Extremely heavy metal rods, fuel rods, and the graphite and the control rods are jumping up and down in the circuits due to the extreme pressure. It has been estimated the power was over 100,000% its design capacity. And of course the core could not hold that together. Explosion occurred. So hopefully now you have an intuition on what went wrong and also learned a little nuclear physics. I basically only cover the physics and the incredibly dangerous design of the RBMK reactor, but there are tons of other factors that also played a role which we didn't cover, such as human errors and unexperienced team, the lack of any safety culture, the ability to turn off safety system, cheap reactors over safety, the Soviet Union and the corrupt system, and more. And now, I don't want you to walk away with the feeling that nuclear reactors are unsafe. This is just one reactor design, and many more safe reactor design exists. For example, ones with the negative void coefficient. They are impossible to blow up. I could simulate that for you one day. And lastly, even including all of the death of this horrible accident, nuclear reactors are still much, much more safe. Thank you for watching.